Hello, I'm Shrimai Prabhumoye, and today I'm going to talk about our work on exploring controllable text generation techniques. Controllable text generation allows us to add knobs to control the attributes of the text to be generated. For example, if the user asks, "Who did you like the best in Avengers?" Now the bot can decide to hallucinate this information, or we can provide the control attributes like Robert Downey Jr. or Scarlett Johansson to the bot so that the bot can respond by saying, "I liked Robert Downey Jr. and Scarlett Johansson in the movie." Similarly, if the user asks, "Did you like the movie?" Now the bot can tailor its responses according to the preferences of the user. For example, if the bot knows that the user likes superhero movies, then the bot can respond with a positive sentiment sentence like, "Yeah, I love the movie." Or if the bot knows that the user does not like such movies, then it can respond with a negative sentiment sentence by saying, "No, I hated it." There are many applications and tasks in the umbrella of controllable text generation, and here I'm going to describe some of them. So, as described in the previous slide, you can control various aspects of dialogue systems. You can control the persona of the dialogue system, the style of the responses, like whether you say something in a polite manner or you show authority in your responses. You can control the content of the responses, and you can control the topic of the conversation. You can recommend polite emails while writing in an email writing app. You can control various aspects of story in the story generation task. Like you can control the plot of the story, the ending of the story, the sentiment of the story, or the sequence of topics in the story. And you can even control the persona of the narrator of the story. And you can, in general, generate entire website or Wikipedia articles by performing content-grounded generation. There is a large body of work in different domains and tasks, and it is very hard to comprehend these complex architectures and how they are connected with each other. And there is no unifying theme to describe this. Hence, we need a schema for controllable text generation models, and that is what this paper is all about. Prior work in controllable text generation has been done independently. Our goal is to organize the various techniques and tasks in controllable text generation and connect them together using a schema. Our schema contains 5 modules, which I will describe shortly. You can use the schema to identify any architecture as belonging to one of the 5 modules. And very importantly, you can use the schema with any algorithmic paradigm like the sequence-to-sequence paradigm or the reinforcement learning paradigm and so on. We wanted to collate knowledge about the different techniques that are used to add control in each of these 5 modules of the schema. We provide qualitative analysis of these techniques and pave way for new architectures. This overview also provides an easy access for comparison. So if you're going to provide a new architecture or propose a new model, then you can easily look up in this particular work and see which other prior works you want to compare yourself with. I will first briefly describe a standard generation process which uses recurrent neural network. And then I will talk about the proposed schema. So the encoder encodes the source sentence by consuming one word at each time step and creates a fixed sized vector HE, which represents the whole of the input sentence. In the standard generation process, HE is passed as an external input to the decoder and the generation process begins. The decoder is given start token at the first time step as an input, and the generator produces an output state O1. O1 is then projected over the vocabulary state followed vocabulary space followed by the softmax function and the argmax function to generate the token yes. The word yes, along with the hidden state that was created at the previous time step, H1, both of these, yes and H1, are passed to the next time step so that the generator produces the output state O2. And this process continues until the decoder generates the end token. Now let's look at the decoder closely and see where can we potentially add the control attribute in this generation process. What can we modify to include the control attribute? We can first of all potentially modify the external input and add control attribute to H0. We can also add control attributes to the sequential input at each time step of the generation. We can make changes to the generator operations itself so that and add control attribute specific parameters to them. We can also modify the output state such that when you generate, the output state actually has the control attribute that you're looking for. And finally, we can also add loss objectives to ensure that the text belongs to the desired control attribute. So finally, here is the schema that is proposed in this paper. We first have the external input H0, which can be changed. Next, we have the sequential input XT at each time step. If you want to see the effect of your control attribute at each time step of the generation. You can also make changes to the operations of the generator itself, and that is the third module. Fourth module is the output space, and once the output state is projected over the vocabulary space to generate the token x hat t is compared with yt, and we can choose how we want to compare these two. So the fifth module is the training objective module. This is the main contribution of this work. In this paper, we describe these five modules of the schema and the various techniques that are used to modify them. This schema organizes the vast amount of prior work in different tasks and domains. So now I will briefly describe only some of the techniques that are used or that are actually described in the paper to modify each of these five modules. These are not new techniques, but this is a new categorization of these techniques. So first of all, you can use the decompose technique to modify the external input module. The encoder representation HE can be decomposed into multiple subspaces, each of which represents a particular control attribute. For example, if you're using this technique for style transfer task, then HE can be decomposed into the meaning subspace and the style subspace. They can then either be combined together and passed to the decoder, or you can choose to just pass one of them. Like in case of style transfer, you can just pass the meaning vector, the meaning subspace. The advantage of this technique is that you get interpretable representation because you can actually query this subspace to see if it actually captures the desired control attribute or not. One of the caveats of this technique is that the input should contain the signal of the control attribute that you're looking for. In a sense that in case of style transfer, let's say you are performing sentiment modification and now your input sentence is a positive sentiment sentence, then you need the input sentence to contain that positive sentiment. Unless you have that, you cannot decompose it into a positive sentiment subspace. This technique works really well with supervision on this decomposed subspace because you want to make sure that these decomposed subspaces actually learn the control attributes that you are looking for. Second is the external feedback, which can be used to modify the external input module. In this case, you can have a regularizer to control HE. So HE is not only passed to the generator, but it is also passed to a discriminator. And the discriminator gives feedback to HE whether it actually contains the desired control attribute or not. In this case, the discriminator must be jointly trained with the generator and the encoder. And this technique is very useful if you combine with the decompose technique because you can use the discriminator to make sure that the decompose spaces actually capture the control attribute of your choice. So you can use it for supervision. There are more techniques described in the paper in detail, like the arithmetic or linear transform technique or the stochastic changes technique. So now let's move to the second module, which is the sequential input module. Similar to the previous module, you can concatenate the attribute vector S or add it to the word embedding at each time step t. Note that in this case, you are making changes to the input of the generator itself and not the context that flows through at each time step. This technique has not shown promising results so far. Now let's talk about the third module, which is the generator operations itself. So you can make changes to the generator operations itself to add for your control attributes. So here I show two examples. The first is an example of modifying the LSTM cell, where in addition to computing how much of the prior context to forget and how much of it to pass to the next time step, you also consider how much of the dialogue act at the current time step should affect the generation of the token at this time step. In the second example, there are changes that are made to the GRU cell where two additional gates are added. The goal select gate controls when the goal of the recipe should be taken into account, and the item select gate controls when the agenda recipe items should be taken into account in the recipe generation task. We also describe in detail the standard generators like recurrent neural networks, transformers, and we also talk about pre-trained language models. Now let's look at the fourth module, which is the output module. The most popular way of modifying the output space is using attention mechanism. Attention lets you focus on particular tokens of the source sequence. There are many different types of attention like global attention, local attention, and multi-headed attention, but I will briefly talk about the global attention here. So when you are generating a token, let's say at time step 2, the generator builds the output state O2, and now we are going to modify this output state so that it pays attention to the source sequence. So we create an alignment matrix A2 which gives a score to each hidden state of the source sequence based on the current state O2. We then get a context vector C2 based on these scores. And finally, we get O hat 2 by concatenating C2 and O2. So now this modified state O hat 2 is what is going to be used to generate the token lets. Attention mechanism has proved to be most effective, especially the self and cross attention used in transformers. In controllable text generation, this is mostly used by adding control attribute tokens to the source sequence so that the self attention can capture it. But this area is underexplored and it has a lot of potential, especially in the space of content grounded generation. In the paper, we talk about more techniques like external feedback technique and the arithmetic or linear transform technique, which can also be used to modify the output space. And finally, let's talk about the training objective module. So typically you use the cross entropy loss for training your decoder. And this is a general loss. There are other general losses like the unlikelihood loss, which basically makes sure that you don't repeat the tokens in your generations. And these losses can be used with any task, any generation task. You can also use decoding strategies like beam search. But you can also add additional loss terms that are specific to your task or what you want to do or the attribute that you want to control. For example, you can use classifier loss where you can design a classifier to make sure and which gives the feedback to the decoder through a loss term that whether the decoder generated a sentence that belongs to the target attribute or not. We describe more loss terms in the paper, KL divergence loss or task specific losses like the coverage loss and structure loss. And the future work for this paper is empirical evaluation of the schema. This is to understand quantitatively which modules are more effective in controlling attributes. We also want to study task-related architectures. So some architectures may be more beneficial for certain kinds of tasks and some may not be. We also want to add these control techniques to pre-trained models like BART and T5. Most of these techniques have been studied in the recurrent neural network framework, But we want to, this is a new space to explore where you can see how to add these techniques to BART 25. Thank you.